So, nehmen Sie bitte Platz, meine Damen und Herren, wir würden gerne beginnen.
Please take your seats, we would like to start.
And we will do the conference in English and German with simultaneous translation. So, for those of you who need translation, please pick up your earphones, headphones. And I'll slip back into my mother tongue. So.
Warm welcome, ladies and gentlemen. And of course, I would like to particularly welcome our international guests. I'm very pleased to note that there's lots of interest in our annual meeting on European policies. It has a tradition. EU quo vadis is the subject. Where are you heading towards Europe? And of course, this question is very topical this year. We are celebrating 60 years of signing of the Treaty of Rome, the inauguration deed, so to speak, of the United Europe, at the time West Europe. Now, today we are at the crossroads in the European Union. On the one hand, and I think more and more people feel this, the need for Europe. It's more needed than ever. But it is under massive attack from the inside and from the outside, though, the European Union. Roughly a year ago, in April 2016, the American-Polish publicist, Applebaum, was publicized, I think it was in the Washington Post. She wrote an essay and she said, the West is maybe three elections away from its self-destruction. And these three elections, she meant were the Brexit decision, American presidential election, and the French presidential elections. And as we all know, two of these two elections went wrong in a way, and that's why we, though, nonetheless believe that in France nothing will go wrong. The effects of Brexit, though, and the American actions will be something we'll be tackling for some while. It's not isolated events anyways. The exit of Great Britain from the European Union, if that materializes, will be an enormous cut. Also, in my environment, there are people who respond saying, at last, we have gotten rid of the Brits. And they saw the Brits as somebody that were hampering European integration. I believe this is not a good thought. I think it's short-sighted because with Great Britain, European Union will not only lose, or would not only lose 20% of its economic power, but also a liberal bastion and one of the few European states with a global agenda. And in upcoming negotiations, which will eat up lots of energies, which would actually be needed for other constructive talks. These negotiations about the modalities of an exit, of course, the European Union has to stand firm by its basic principles. Can't be a specific rebate, so to speak, for Great Britain when it is about that link between in single market, internal market, and freedom of movement. But at the same time, it will be smart to leave a door open should the Brits would like to come back. Now, that British vote for Brexit is not just a one-off effect. In all of Europe, like in America, we have a deep-rooted anti-liberal revolt from Scandinavia to the Mediterranean, from the Atlantic coast right down to East Europe. Nationalistic, xenophobic, authoritarian parties get 20 to 30% of the vote. And in many countries, they still characterize the public discussion. The good news is, following the Trump shock, the victory of Alexander von Bellen at the Austrian presidential elections, that a little bit of a stopper for Geert Wilders in the Netherlands, and the current polls in France, the peak of that anti-liberal wave appears to have been broken, and there's more people advocating European Union again. There is a new civil movement for Europe that is spreading. Last week, there were demonstrations under European flags in more than 50 cities, and Alexander Freiherr Knigge, one of the initiators of Pulse of Europe in Berlin, will be speaking here at the conference later on. The French presidential election candidate, Emmanuel Macron, is a sign of hope. Why? Because he has a positive agenda, not just with a view to the European Union, but also for France, a reform agenda he has. And he is counting on optimism instead of fear. And that is key in dealing with the nationalists and the authoritarian forces. Their political currency is fear, is anxiety, is playing with angst, and that's what we have to oppose by a sign of optimism. Not embellishing things, but instilling some conviction that we will find solutions to the self-generated problems. Despite these positive signs, it is too early to say there's no threat anymore. In many European societies, there's still a basic feeling of uncertainty. People are nervous. Basic problems have not been solved. That holds true for the debt crisis following the banking crisis of 2007 and 2008. It holds true for the youth unemployment, which is at a horrible rate in various European countries, for the growing social divide in our societies, and for this expanding pessimism with regards to the future. One believes one's own situation is okay, but for the first time since the Second World War, a majority of the European population does no longer believe that the next generation, that our children, will be better off. At the same time, there is a massive divide, at least with regards to two issues in Europe. The European Union, which is, for one, is a refugee policy. The decision of the federal government and Angela Merkel in a dramatic humanitarian situation where the refugees from Syria got stuck in Hungary, opening up the borders. And for one, for some, it was acknowledging, reinforcing European principles, and for the others, it was a completely wrong thing to do. And there is that divide that is continuing, and we have not managed so far to agree on a common migration and refugee policy in Europe. And that same holds true for the debt crisis, the political dimension of which many of us have underestimated. It's not just an economic question or political question, but because as a consequence, there's a political divide opening up between the debtors and the creditor states in Europe. And this divide is also a very emotional one and remains one of the central challenges of European policy when it is about bringing more communality, bringing more unity. At the same time, we are confronted by challenges from outside. Our eyes are on the American president currently. We must not forget, though, that the heftiest attack on the European peace order comes from Russia, with the annexation of the Crimea and that covert war in the East Ukraine. President Putin has put in question central principles of that peace order in Europe, the same sovereignty of all European countries, and their right to decide which alliance they belong to. This is a conflict that has by far not come to an end. It has importance beyond Europe, Ukraine. It is the question whether we go back to Yalta, dividing Europe into two zones dominated by two hegemonial powers, or whether we continue to move into the direction of a European peace order, which is resting on the same sovereignty for all states. Russia is not just an external power. It's not just a neighbor of Europe. The Kremlin is the center of an anti-liberal international, builds networks, expands these networks to anti-European parties on the left and on the right, and does massively do propaganda in TV, radio, etc. Has become part of European reality. Now, the development in Turkey which affects us massively, like in Russia, as a foundation, because our partners are under more and more pressure. Some are in jail, are in exile, and the space for democratic civil society, for democratic public is diminishing, and the authoritarian changes in the Turkey will have effects on the European security policy. Turkey, of course, is a key state for the southeast flank of Europe, but also with regards to the effects on our societies, where we have a higher share of migrants coming from Turkey. And also, to mention a third external factor which you cannot ignore, on the other side of the Atlantic, it's not clear who will have the upper hand. The forces around Donald Trump, which count on a weakening or destruction of the European Union, or those forces which understand that a strong Europe is also in the interest of the United States. And but all with all this anxiety, with all these concerns, and caused by the new administration in the U.S., I have I've never seen such an interest in Europe and the U.S. than in recent months. So obviously, there is also an interest in a renewed transatlantic alliance of the Democrats and or democratic forces, and that is something that we should spur and not say farewell to the transatlantic alliance. In light of this crisis, now more than ever is a good reflex, but muddling through like we used to is not a good idea. But we have to rethink basically the structure of the European Union. We have grown accustomed to host to specifically for my political family to see the ever more close integration of Europe as a fact into one state, in a single state. But now we have to rediscuss this. The growing centralization of political forces in a government is not the sole alternative to a sneaking renationalization. It is not supported by a majority of the population in no country. That's why we have to rediscuss how EU can bring these various different strands together. Diversity, economy, unity and diversity. That must be the central formula of, and must remain the central formula of the European project. And now, what do we need to do? We need to think. And what do we need to think is how these values, human rights convention, European Parliament, etc., how we can bring them together with flexible forms of integration. That is a question which pops up more frequently under the discussion of that Europe of various speeds. That has a certain plausibility in it. At the same time, you have to be very sober here and think how more cooperation under the European Union method, in the Euro and the Schengen, where not all the European states are sitting in the same boat, whether this, what this will have an effect on the European Commission. Maybe it is erroneous now to discuss questions regarding the constitution of the European Union instead of political initiatives for urgent questions where Europe means added value for the citizens of Europe. There is a whole host of subject matters where the majority of Europeans would wish to have more European cooperation, security within and outside the EU, climate protection, energy, modernization of European transport networks, sustainable growth, and a joint migration and refugee policies, therefore should be central to the European agenda. You must not wait, though, until all the member states have agreed on the smallest common denominator. Ambitious collisions of the willing may also bring new momentum into the European project. So, sufficient items for a exciting discussion. Today's debate will be continued tomorrow with an expert meeting, and we hope to get from these 2 days not just a lively discussion, but concrete answers to the question, what should we be doing? To conclude, I would like to thank most cordially all the speakers. To like to thank our cooperation partner, the European Green Foundation, and specifically the preparation team of the Heinrich-Böll Foundation. I'd like to thank Christine Pütz and her team and the organization office of the foundation that is going to be your host today and tomorrow. Thank you. Thanks for coming. Thanks for your attention. And now I would like to pass the floor to Lucile Schmid. She is the board chairman of the board of the European Foundation.
Thank you very much, Ralf Fücks. I won't speak in my mother tongue, but I'll do my best. I'm very happy to co-introduce this conference on these 2 days of meetings of on moving forward with Europe and with the 60 years anniversary after signing the Rome Treaty. And I wanted to begin my speech by giving you an image of what is the presidential debate in France today, because last week we had the 11 confirmed candidates, and we can say that among these candidates, the ones being in favor of Europe are minor. They are in minority. We could say that of the 11 candidates, we could say that 7 to 8 are against the future of Europe. And I think this is a striking image when you think that France was one of the countries having founded the European Union. So we see the complexity of this situation. And this is not only entire European being in a kind of neutrality towards Europe. As you know, it's very strong and vigorous form of anti-Europeanism. And this is something I think we should take into account. And I wanted to add that we have anti-European inside, and as Ralf Fuchs was saying, we have it outside at the same time. So these insiders and outsiders being anti-Europeans is certainly something changing the general context in which we have to think and to try to define common proposal during these two days. And I would ask, an interesting question is, shouldn't we consider ourselves much more as an active minority than belonging to a consensus majority when we are defending and promoting Europe? Shouldn't we change the methods we use? I think this is a major question today. I wanted to quote the Jeff studies we made on the question of the future of Europe, and just to give you three elements outside of these studies, I wanted to quote three main things which might explain this European crisis. First of all, the growing gap between the promise and reality. When you look at the opinion polls, lots of Europeans would like Europe to take care of the social policies and of the question of citizenship, and these are the subjects on which European competencies are among the weakest. This is an image of the growing gap. The second thing I would say, which is very important, and we see the same in France, is the question of bureaucracy and the question of the fact and the lack of the growing lack of legitimacy of European institutions. The fact that Europe is visible on questions which are difficult to understand and which sometimes are very annoying for citizens and societies is certainly one of its main weaknesses, whereas at the same time, the positive things Europe is performing are not visible. So this invisibility of positive Europe and the visibility of Europe complexifying things is, I think, one of the main things we have to take into account and to work on it. The third thing is certainly the fact that Europe didn't achieve its complete settling in the international relationships. Ralf Fuchs talked a lot about the question of superpowers, and it is certainly difficult to define Europe as a superpower. I would just take the French example of COP21. As you might have noticed, it was very interesting exceptional achievement for the French diplomacy and for the fact that we managed to have an international agreement on fighting the climate deregulation. But it was at the same time a clear example of the fact that Europe was divided on these issues, especially on the energy issues. And when in 1997 Europe played a very important role in the Kyoto issue, we can't say that 15-20 years after, Europe is still having the same kind of position on the international scene. I would add another issue between proposing two main orientations for our works for these 2 days. It's not that easy to link Europe and green issues. Ralf Fücks was referring to Emmanuel Macron, who might be the future French president. But you have to know that in the French campaign, Emmanuel Macron is seen as being very reluctant on green issues, and is liberal on economics, is interesting, is liberal on social issues, and in ways is the image of a kind of progress for France, and he's only 39 when we've been used to old politicians. But on green issues, he regularly escapes giving answers, and it seems that linking green issues and European future is not something which is so obvious as we might imagine in our assistance, because I feel that we are pro-European, and of course we are convinced Greens, but we have to think about the link between those two issues and the way we make it realistic. So I will end by proposing two orientations for our future work. The first is to consider ourselves as an active minority, as we are pro-European, and thinking of us as challenging our adversaries on the ground of their projects. I think this is quite important, and I think we shouldn't only concentrate on the questions of persons and leadership, because I feel, for example, that in France, Marine Le Pen has been challenged a lot on her person and not on the ground of her program, and that her program is, of course, very unrealistic, but you have to demonstrate that because it managed to seem very simple and to be understandable for people. The second thing I would say is that we should work on the questions which make Europe visible or invisible. The question of making visible issues which might have an impact on people's life on a positive way is certainly something which is very important. And it means that we should find new methods, open new spaces, and at the same time probably concentrate or open space on new subjects. Of course, the question of diversity of culture is very important, and it's something, for example, in France, we see that culture is not at all present in the campaign, and so it means that we abandon cultural issues to conservative and reactionary parties. The question of the Green Project and the link with Europe, of course, is something on which we have been working for years, but we should probably find new ways to make it understandable and realistic. And I think that we should work on debureaucratization too. What do I mean? I mean that the question of legitimacy of the institution, the fact that we should make things more simple and introduce some more some society of confidence and truth is something which is very important, and that it might help citizens to find themselves as being European citizens and not finding that Europe is so far away from themselves. So we should imagine something like a new Europe, but with new methods, and be conscious that having the methods of an active minority, we are used for that for the green affairs, should be introduced in the European questions too. Thank you very much.
Geht. Ich dachte kurz, ich käme da jetzt nicht ran und meine Arme wären zu kurz, aber so ist noch nicht. Vielen Dank, meine.
Thank you. I'm Silke Temple, editor-in-chief of the journal International Policy, and I'm often here at the Heinrich-Böll-Foundation, and I like to be here, and I'm also happy to be the host of the talk we are going to have later. But first of all, there will be two keynote speeches for us, both dealing with the question of Europe and with the fundamental question, Europe, why? And are we reaching the end of the European integration after a period of 60 years? I think it's also charming, so to speak, to have two speakers now who come from countries where the question about Europe was raised, first of all, the United States and the UK. Andrew Moravcsik is going to be the first speaker. He is a professor of politics and international affairs and
an experienced expert in the field of negotiations, but he's also an opera buff, an opera aficionado. And together with his wife, he has also pondered the question why women can't have it all. So he's going to be the first speaker, and he will ponder the question, Europe, why, how do we need to redefine the European project, please?
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. Ich sollte mich am Anfang entschuldigen bei allen.
And please bear with me, and I'd like to apologize to all who speak German and also to the French, because I will give my presentation in English. Many years ago, I studied in Germany, but as you can hear, my German is not sufficient for the speech I want to give here.
English. So today, the European Union is in crisis. Politicians, journalists, think tank specialists, and professors openly predict that Europe may well collapse. If I know my good friend Jan Žilanka, he may provoke us in that direction a little bit. Some hope it will collapse, but I'm going to take the position today that the EU is far stronger and far more stable than the pessimists believe. This year we celebrate its 60th anniversary, which is a longer period, 60 years, than most nations have been nations in the world today. The EU remains the most ambitious and the most successful example of voluntary international cooperation in history. And I believe it is so deeply embedded in the everyday life of Europeans of all kinds that there is no chance it will disappear soon. And the EU's most important functions, assuring free trade and investment, providing regulatory protection within the single market, allowing free movement of people, coordinating homeland security and undertaking many kinds of foreign and security policy, defense, action, remain essentially untouched by the current crisis. Yet even if we examine the four examples of the greatest crisis, and those I think are geopolitical decline, right-wing radicalism, migration, and the euro, Europe is doing surprisingly well. So let's briefly consider each one of those four crises. That's my job today. Crisis number one, international decline. So the conventional wisdom among all those journalists and think tank people, professors like myself, is that Europe today is a weak international actor, overshadowed by the US and China. It's beset with slow economic and demographic growth. It's disunified, so it doesn't use whatever power it possesses. And if it wants to be stronger, people say, it needs to start by spending more on the military and centralizing more policies in the European Union. This, I believe, is incorrect. Europe remains one of two of the most influential political actors in contemporary global politics, alongside the United States. In almost all respects, it is more influential than China, Russia, or India, and will remain so for at least a generation. Contrary to what President Trump says, many things are contrary to what President Trump says, but neither Europe nor the world really needs more European defense spending. Europe is already the world's second largest military power, spending more than China, and it also acts more in the world than China or Russia. No other single country except the United States can equal this record. At least 25,000 European soldiers, whether you think it's good or not, have been continuously active in dozens of combat missions every single year since the end of the Cold War. China, India, and Russia do nothing comparable in the international system. But far more important than Europe's non-military capabilities is its civilian power, which is really unique. Its trade, its foreign aid, its support for international law and institutions, for European enlargement, lots of things like foundations like this one and universities, its political and cultural values. In all of these areas, Europe remains preeminent in the world in terms of using these things for effective and progressive foreign policy. Far beyond, again, Russia, China, India, in some cases surpassing even the United States. And this active civilian role will become far more important because President Trump intends to gut America's State Department, diplomats, foreign economic policies, and institutional commitments in order to spend more on the military. Consider just one example of this, namely Western policy toward Russia. So obviously, no one could stop Putin entirely from intervening in a country like Ukraine, which is right on his borders, and in which Russia attributes great strategic importance. Yet it has been important for the West, as Ralf Fücks said, to limit the impact of Russian intervention, to defend Ukraine as best we can, and to respond strongly to actions which violate the most fundamental principles of Western international law. Given that all Western countries, including the United States, rejected military intervention in Ukraine from the very start, the United States had almost no tools with which to oppose Russia in Ukraine. Yet Europe had the most powerful civilian power tools that America lacks. European policy is 90%, and I mean that very precisely, 90% of what the West has done in response to Ukraine. Most effectively, it's given economic aid to Ukraine, without which the country would long since have collapsed. Over 90% of that comes from Europe. It has engaged in trade liberalization, which permits Ukraine to diversify its trade and, importantly, energy supplies. Over 90% of that trade is with Europe. It has engaged in diplomacy, which has stopped the war to a trickle and is working slowly toward a settlement. Over 90% of the diplomatic meetings with Putin are by Europeans. And though least important, but most remarked in the newspapers, there is sanction policy to punish Russia, and over 90% of the costs of sanctions are paid by the Europeans because the United States basically doesn't trade with Russia. Russia is only one of many examples. You could cite Iran, Libya, North Africa, the Red Sea, climate change, human rights, the global trading system, development aid, and much else, in which Europe really plays the predominant role. So let's go to the second crisis, right-wing radicalism and Brexit, about which we just heard. The conventional wisdom that this poses a mortal threat to Europe, and it may serve as a model for Brexit may serve as a model for many other countries to do similarly. I think this pessimism is also unwarranted. First, Brexit, at least as the British government imagines it, is unsustainable. Britain simply cannot withdraw from long-standing arrangements that coordinate European trade, investment, service protection, provision, travel, regulation, anti-crime and terrorism policies, information sharing on migrants and foreign and defense policy. It can change their name. It can change the institutional form. But Theresa May's negotiating position is to keep every one of those policies except future migration from Europe into Britain the same. In other words, whatever we choose to call it, legally, Britain cannot afford to change the status quo, a conservative government least of all. And this is likely to force the British to compromise over the long period, perhaps 5 to 10 years, that will take to complete negotiations. And I agree with Ralf Fücks that a multi-speed Europe, which is what we have already had for 25 years, but now finally people in Brussels will say so, a multi-speed Europe will help. Second, Brexit is unlikely to spread. Where else in Europe could a genuinely right-wing Eurosceptic government actually trigger an attempt to leave the European Union? Not in the Netherlands, we've just learned. Not in France, where Marine Le Pen has next to no chance to win the second round of the election. Even Eurosceptic governments in Hungary and Poland have made no move to leave the EU, which would be suicidal. So the European Eurosceptic challenge, I think, politically unpleasant and difficult though it is not a mortal threat to Europe. So that brings us to the third crisis, migration. So again, the conventional wisdom among many journalists and think tankers and academics is that external migration threatens the future of Europe because Europe cannot control its external borders and because it has failed to allocate refugees among European countries. Now let's be realistic here. Every European government understands in the short and medium term one central truth, and that is that continued immigration at the level of 2015 is politically unsustainable. I admire very much what this country did in 2015, but it cannot do it year in and year out, and neither can anybody else. So the goal is how to, in the maximally humane and efficient way, limit immigration into the EU, a far more important goal than unrealistic schemes to empower Brussels to allocate refugees here and there. And it has been remarkably successful in this. So the level of Mediterranean migration to Greece and Italy, over 1 million people in 2015, has been cut to a third of that and continues to fall over this winter. Why? Because Europe is engaged in a set of policies that, although we may not approve of them ethically or otherwise, are politically necessary. They have coordinated and funded new legal procedures to criminalize transport and trafficking. They've constructed fences and walls between Turkey and Greece and Bulgaria. They've negotiated agreements with countries like Turkey and Libya to strengthen the management of refugee flows, and that's basically what Federica Mogherini's been doing for the last 6 months. And it's helping to strengthen joint naval patrols in the Mediterranean. None of this would be even feasible without the European Union, and all of it is, within the realistic terms of modern politics, relatively successful. So that's all the good news. I have one fourth crisis that is I'm a little bit soberer about, and that is the crisis of slow growth, inequality, and the euro. So, oddly enough, of all the crises facing Europe, this is the one where journalists, think tankers, and academics tend to be most optimistic. Many argue that, well, the euro doesn't really cause slow growth, or it's stable because macroeconomic problems are resolving themselves, because you can see it's still there after 15 years, or these problems can be addressed through European banking union or fiscal union, and it'll all be okay. Here, I'm more cautious. This is a serious issue. Overall, European growth in real per capita income, so Wachstumsrate des Pro-Kopf-Real-Einkommens, is not bad compared to the United States and Japan and even Britain, but it's unequally distributed within Europe. Some countries are condemned, as Ralf Fücks said, to permanent austerity. Since 2008, Germany's per capita real income has increased by 6%. In the same period, France, the Netherlands, and Denmark have been stuck at zero. Spain has declined by 6%, Portugal by 10%, Italy by 12%, Cyprus by 16%, and Greece by 25%. That means your average person in these countries is that much poorer. This slow growth has many causes, but one is surely the euro. Elementary modern monetary economics tells us that Europe is too diverse to healthily sustain a single currency with a single monetary policy and a single exchange rate. And when policies diverge, it is the deficit countries that pay the cost. A country like Italy Traditionally, Europe's second largest exporter is now slated to be Europe's next big crisis country. Without effective monetary instruments, and particularly without exchange rate devaluation, these countries are powerless to stimulate macroeconomic performance. They are condemned to permanent austerity. Meanwhile, Germany, for whom the euro offers the same effect as a real devaluation of the currency, has cheapened its exports and racked up trade surpluses as large as China. I do not agree with President Trump about almost anything, but he happens to be right about this. Something needs to be done, and it's hard to know what. Some concede that the euro is bad policy, yet favor retaining it because it's part of the European project, and Europeans might lose faith in the EU. I think this is just plain factually incorrect. The number one factor sapping support for Europe today, along with migration, is bad policy that generates low growth. Europe's popularity and reputation among national publics has plummeted, and that fall starts exactly in 2008. And it has empowered right-wing nationalists and Euroskeptics who in almost no other issue area deserve it. Still others call for an EU fiscal union. Fiscal union remains impossible. Can anyone seriously imagine Germans transferring 10 or 20% of their GDP to other countries, which is roughly the minimum that would be required to have a serious macroeconomic effect on current inequality? The best solution perhaps would be to dismantle the euro, at least for some countries. Some object that this would be difficult and costly, but could it possibly be more costly than 10 or 15 years of austerity? The real problem is that both politicians and voters dislike enlightened policies that create short-term costs, and they won't do it. Therefore, the status quo appears to be to muddle through with the current euro system and small reforms. Ironically, this arises not because of Europe's weakness, but in a sense because of its strength in this particular policy issue, the stability of this policy, but it's bad for Europe, bad for Europe's reputation and for its capabilities. So let me conclude by addressing one deeper question that is perhaps in your minds. If this is correct, that Europe really largely does better than people think, why does it have such a bad reputation? Why does criticism of Europe get such disproportionate attention while Europe's successes receive little attention? I like Lucille's suggestion that it's partly because the issues that are going badly are more salient to voters, but I think there are other things at work as well. Everybody in European polities has an incentive to criticize Europe. Yes, of course, they're the Euroskeptics who don't believe in Europe, and yes, of course, they're national politicians who take credit for the Europe's successes, but pass the blame for bad policies onto Europe. But an odd third group that undermines Europe's reputation are European federal idealists. It's ironic that those who believe most in ever closer union and a federal Europe are often Europe's most vicious critics. Why? Because they are legal perfectionists. They trumpet every crisis, every imperfection, every situation where European countries don't all agree as evidence we need more centralized Europe. This often makes them in practice more critical of Europe than those who are skeptical of it, or realistic at least. They hold Europe to unrealistic standards of democracy, effectiveness, and morality, higher ones than any national government can obtain. And they dislike messy compromises that work well enough. Let me give one small example, the 2011 intervention in Libya. Now, maybe in retrospect, it was a bad idea to intervene in Libya, but the action itself was remarkably successful. Europe decided to act, dragged a skeptical United States and 18 other countries into it, prevailed on the ground and in the air in a few months, achieved its short-term humanitarian and political goals, generated much of the short-term goodwill in Libya, and all this for 1 billion euros, 75% of which was paid by Europeans. This seems to me, as an American, very successful compared to the US, which has spent 2 trillion euros, 3,000 lives, American lives, and untold hundreds of thousands of foreign lives, and is still in Iraq after 15 years with nothing to show for it. Yet, at the time and ever since, at the time of the Libya intervention, almost every commentator in Europe called the Libyan operation a failure. Why? Because states acted through NATO rather than acting through official EU policy. Because some major EU members didn't show up, like Germany. Because Europeans needed to cooperate with non-Europeans in order to achieve things. And because military leaders complained, as they always complain, that they needed more equipment. This kind of criticism privileges perfection over policy that is practically successful. And finally, there are journalists, sensationalist and headline-seeking journalists, Sensationsmacher and Schlagzeilenhascherei in the journalistic world. Take it from me. It's my job to study Europe professionally, and it is totally boring, really boring. Hence, newspaper and TV editors want to publish something interesting. And that always means not saying, well, the EU has muddled through and been moderately successful in this or that issue. This is publishing stories that criticize Europe. Now, sometimes they're fake news. Let's not forget that the British Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson literally made his career publishing stories from Brussels that weren't even close to being true. And even in Germany, a country with a sensible, intelligent press, mostly, one still reads stories saying that 80% of national laws come from Brussels when the real number is 10%. Yet even when stories are true, the interpretation is often biased against Europe. A simple example we see around us every day now from France, Marine Le Pen has received an unbelievable amount of press for the possibility that she will do well in the first round of the upcoming French election. It's as if she were already ruling France. That the truth is that it's only the second round of the election that actually selects the French president, and that is almost certain to be an embarrassing failure for her, just like it was for her father. Nobody says that Le Pen's National Front only has 2 seats in the French parliament, or that the United Kingdom Independence Party, UKIP, has never had a seat in the European Parliament. In the British Parliament. Ironically, the only place where someone like Nigel Farage and Marine Le Pen can consistently get elected is the European Parliament, the parliament of that supposedly undemocratic EU. And yet, the press portrays such people as all-powerful. So my friends, what we need is a new European public discourse. I think this is particularly important in combating the right. I agree with what Ralf Fuchs put very nicely at the start, deren Mittel ist die Furcht. It should be pragmatic rather than idealistic, substantive rather than formalistic. It should focus on practical successes in helping Europeans or rejecting idealist proposals with little chance to be sustained. And it should highlight, above all, the indispensable and positive role that a united Europe plays in the world. And I think, also agreeing with Ralf, that unity in diversity, Einheit in der Vielfalt, is a much better slogan than ever closer union. In short, we need a public discourse that tells the simple truth about Europe. After 60 largely successful years of European integration, Europeans deserve no less. Thank you for your attention.
Vielen Dank. Wenn ich das jetzt ganz kurz zusammenfassen würde, würde ich sagen,
to put it in a nutshell, Europe is still better than most think in terms of foreign policy. Secondly, it's this homemade image problem. With these friends, you don't need enemies. And we have a time bomb in the form of the euro. We'll be talking about that in a minute. But we also have done Sri Lanka here, who has also lectured in Florence, Leiden, Oxford, what have you. Are we at the end of the integration process after 60 years? That is the question. Mr. Sri Lanka.
Thank you, thank you. I'm delighted to be here again. When Ralf and Andy debated Europe last time, we talk about the crisis of European integration. Andy, as always, gave us good news. I gave you bad news, and Ralf tried to moderate. But I think we moved since. We don't just have a crisis of European integration. We have a crisis of liberal order in Europe on our hands. Across the continent, and I'm not going to steal Andy Broad to talk what has happened on the other side of the Atlantic, but across continent, some basic pillars of this liberal order are being under attack. Not just open borders and integration, but liberal democracy and free trade, migration, and multicultural society, historical truths and political correctness, moderate political parties and mainstream media, cultural tolerance and religious neutrality. Now, liberal ideas influenced various generations of politicians since the age of Enlightenment, but we can say that 1989 was the triumph of liberal ideas in Europe. And the fall of Berlin, with the fall of Berlin Wall, liberals became the only game in town across the whole continent. And you know, my patron, Ralf Dahrendorf, used to talk about liberal revolution. Well, we now face anti-liberal counter-revolution. And these counter-revolutions, of course, manifest itself differently in different places. I mean, Germany is in a different position than Cyprus, let's put it mildly. But there are some common lines. Look at two politicians, these two counter-revolutionary insurgents, who do not look like twin brothers, Jarosław Kaczyński and Alexander Tsipras. You know, Kaczyński is ultra-conservative. Tsipras is, of course, radically leftist. Kaczyński sees Russia as a threat. Tsipras looks at Russia as an ally. Kaczyński just wants to do some minor polishing of neoliberal economics, while Tsipras, of course, wants to get rid of it. Kaczyński is absolutely against refugees, while Tsipras wants to have simply a just reallocations of refugees. But they have one thing in common. They both demand a fundamentally new regime in Europe, or at least in their countries. And they love the elite which ran Europe for the last three decades, and their countries. And those insurgents are on the rise. And liberals are clearly in retreat. When liberals prevail, like a few days ago in Holland, you know, I still have my Dutch passport, you know. They are prevailing because they are embracing a soft versions of populism. Have you read Prime Minister Rutte's open letter few weeks before elections? If you don't like our culture, move out. Or have you read in Italy the new Minniti decree? You know, left-wing party running Italian government. Eh? And Mr. Minniti was a former communist, by the way. You know, giving mayors the right to ban certain kind of people from city centers. These are not drug dealers or criminals, for this is a penal law, yeah? These are poor people, clochards, those who are begging, those who may be in cities dominated by Lega Nord with Burka. You may say soft populism is better than hard one. Mr. Rutte himself talked about good populism versus the bad one. And you can say soft populists are ours, so we can trust them. Well, I'm not sure about that. And I know that populism and liberalism are rather strange bedfellows. In my view, the counter-revolution progresses not because those people like Kaczynski or Le Pen are so bright and charismatic. I don't think they are. They are making progress because we are so weak. Because the liberals are so weak these days. We look at our record in the last two or three decades. We tolerated growing inequalities. And in a way, the whole neoliberal economics can be summarized in one sentence. You know, socialism for the rich, capitalism for the poor, right? We tolerated public surveillance of private communications. We engage in military adventures, such as the one in Iraq, and sorry, also in Libya. When you think about success in Libya and the migrants coming now from Libya on the Italian shores, well, there is a certain definition of success here. And we even justify torture. We justify torture. You know, and on Europe, our record is not so impressive either. You know, European integrations was supposed to get rid of power politics. Large and rich states were no longer to bully the small and impoverished one. And above all, Europe was not supposed to be run by this country, right? Well, and where we are now? You want to arrange anything in Europe? You go to Brussels or to go to Berlin? You know, the triple-A countries basically run Europe with Germany at its helm. New treaties are being written on with some states in mind. And you know, interference in domestic affairs abounds. Punishment rather than incentives are the order of the day. European integration was supposed to make us the most competitive economy in Europe, no, in the world. We were supposed to replace Washington consensus by Stockholm consensus, not only in the Protestant countries, but also in the South. And Europe was supposed to integrate us. Well, has it? Has Euro integrated us or divided us? With, you know, with surplus and deficit countries, you know, so-called peaks, you know what I mean, against the triple-A countries? And think about welfare, which is being slashed even in Scandinavian countries these days. And the EU was supposed to be, you know, it was not supposed to be, it has been a very powerful, influential actor, providing peace and stability, but no longer. I mean, we have a major instability in our neighbors, Ukraine and Turkey. What we can do about it? European clash in the UN Security Councils, and I'm not even talking about the European External Action Service or the neighborhood policy. Things have not been as they used to be in recent years. Because I don't question the whole positive legacy of the European integration. But something has gone wrong too. And where we were when things starting to get hot, when the new kids of the block started to win public support, we just engaged in enormous PR campaigns, began to spin facts, began to attack, you know, political opponents. We never look into the mirror. We even accused electorate of getting stupid or being, you know, easily manipulated by those populists. I mean, after last elections in Poland, when Kaczyński won, Adam Michnik, who is, you know, the leader of liberal establishment, not just in Poland, he gave an interview in his newspaper when he was asked, so how it was possible that Kaczyński won? He said, you know, it's like this pretty woman who goes to bed with who gets drunk and goes to bed with a bastard. And he said it one paragraph after he said that you know, the Polish woman can really stand up to Kaczyński because of anti-abortion, you know, law. This is where we are. When Farage and Le Pen won elections to the European Parliament, what do we have done? We announced a triumph of democracy because Mr. Juncker was a Spitzenkandidat. In Italy, I would have to vote Berlusconi in order to get Mr. Juncker as the president of the European Commission. When Brexit happened, we elected Mr. Tajani, actually the body of Berlusconi, his spokesman covering things up, you know, as the president of the European Parliament. Berlusconi doesn't even have any serious representation in Italian Parliament. Who Mr. Tajani represents in Europe is, for me, a very interesting question. There was little self-criticism and little self-reflections. How many times I heard liberals saying, of course we're against torture, but you know, we don't want our freedom to be taken away by Islamic fundamentalists. Of course refugees should be granted asylum, but let's keep them in Turkey's in asylum camps, you know. And besides, you know, we don't know, they might be terrorists, our countries are full anyway, you know, and we are not used to people from different cultures and religions. How many times I heard liberals saying, well, of course we are in favor of social justice, but you know, we cannot strangle our economies by burdening enterprises, by all these labor rights and taxes. No, we cannot do that. And what about reforms? Can you mention any serious reform of the EU, let alone capitalism and democracy? Do you really believe that what Keynes' disciple today, by the way, idea invented by Milton Friedman, helicopter money, will save capitalists from neoliberal madness? Do you really believe that if president of the European Commission will be elected directly, people will immediately start to love the European Commission and the Union? Do you believe that Greece will ever pay its debt after all three bailouts? Do you believe that the deal with Turkey on refugees is sustainable? So much about good news which we get from successive European, you know, councils. They just tweet us, everything is under control, send us beautiful picture of smiling leaders, which is of course a progress, you know. They come there, they talk. Have they solved very much? Do you believe they did? And don't get me wrong. I'm a convinced liberal, and I'm deeply, very deeply concerned about the rise of illiberal politics. But I'm not interested in joining the liberal propaganda of success. The proponents of this propaganda should ask themselves a very simple question. If the last three decades of the liberal rule was such a great success, why is it so bad? Why so many people hate liberals and vote for our adversaries? Why? For the last three decades, liberalism was an ideology of power and empowerment. Everything was liberal in some sense, and questioning liberal principles, you know, was totally uncommon. Former communists sat in the same train with no liberals and happily going further. Together, by the way, with many opportunists hoping to advance their careers. And I feel little in common with those liberal fellow travelers. They are just liberal fellow travelers. And in order to get those things right, we have to understand what liberalism is and what it is not. We need to decide which streams of liberalism we want to refute and which we want to support. And we need to reclaim our integration project for those who really care about Europe and its citizens. We have to look into the mirror before we start finger pointing, because without this, we will never regain trust of the electorate. That's it.
Stay up on stage, because we sit down. No, come back on stage, you two. Hug him as much as you need. Ralf. Ja, da geht's auch auf. Vielen Dank. Ich glaube, ich bleibe jetzt mal weiter dabei.
I will now talk German. There's simultaneous translation, and I see that. I have a tendency to talk fast, and if you can't manage, then wave. Thanks for the translation. When I was listening to you, was reminded of political orders like computers, and we need hardware, we need institutions, and facilitate things working. At the same time, we need a software, though, which is basically renewable, which is revisable, downloadable, new releases, and Jan Sielonka talked about the crisis of liberalism, and in the European Union, we talked for decades about the European institution, and we talked about the institutions. We always said we need more, we need stronger, we need more interconnection here. That was our idea of Europe, and now comes somebody here and says, wait a minute, we have to talk about the software, about the political culture, about what supports all that, what has supported the European Union has been the liberal idea. But we haven't talked about it anymore. We talked about the peace project and the affluence project. Europe and no longer talk about liberalism. Since Ralf Fücks has been dealing intensively with the issue of freedom, I have a question to all the three of you. Is it about time to talk about the software again? Deal with this, the software, about the political culture? That's what makes the European heart beating. Still, thinking about these two talks and about the different realities that they pictured. This is a criteria of what Jan Zielonka prophesied. I try to connect between and mediate between these two analyses. They have more than just a grain of truth in them, in describing the situation which we're in politically in Europe. I would agree with Adam Moravcsik by saying the success of Europe is better than the reputation. And also would like to add, democracy is much more stable and institutionally enshrined than in the past. Sometimes they draw this analogy with the 30s or 20s of the last century. There's a fundamental difference between then and now, not only because democratic institutions are much more robust today, and also, as you were saying, the democratic mindset is enshrined in Europe, yeah. And I myself talk about the anti-liberal revolt. Jens Lange talks about an anti-liberal counter-revolution. It is astonishing here that there is a liberal counter-movement that that was triggered, and I am quite positive. I believe that Brexit and Trump and also the presidential campaign in France and also in Holland here, the discussion there, are kind of like a wake-up call for Europe, and that that we're not on the down, not downhill here, where the anti-liberal is becoming stronger and stronger and liberal democracy is eroding more and more. At the same time, I very much share Jan's appeal here. Please look in the mirror and ask ourselves what's gone wrong. What's the root cause? What's the reasons for the liberal democracy becoming so discredited? And I would include the U.S. in this. It's not demagogic qualities of the populace. No, obviously something has gone terribly wrong over the last two decades in our societies, which provided the breeding ground for this populism and which led to this crisis of credibility. I think there's so many things coming together here, things that are not in the power of democratic governments to rectify, but rather we are at a point in time where we have a modernity crisis, where we have fundamental changes colliding, which cause this feeling of uncertainty, of nervousness, economic globalization, more locational competitiveness, pressure in the middle classes here, but also cultural revolution, the dissolution of the patriarchal family, gender revolution. I mean, it's really going down to the nitty-gritties of the society. There's worlds colliding and collapsing, rather. Globally, global migration, yes, there's friction, there's massive changes also in our everyday lives. And if you then add the digital revolution with all the concerns that entire industries will vanish in the haze, digital unemployment, if you don't think that this materializes, but it is there, it is a real concern. And I believe here, politicians appear to be rather helpless. That is a core problem. So we have to regain trust in the power of democratic policies in the light of all these major changes. And for that, you need the European Union. Andy Moravcsik's success model. And also add Ralf's idea. You insist on more optimism, but paradoxically we do that in a moment where Well, Europe has never been so secure, despite the internal crisis, with more affluent than ever before, and has a deep-rooted democratic culture than ever before in history. And sometimes I have the feeling that these major projects that success kills the beast, so that Europe could be killed by its own success. If you look at the counter movement, there was a simple answer to all of this, which is to regain control. That was the core in the Brexit. That was the core of all populist parties. And the question is Europe, in its integration speed that it has had, transformation happened fairly fast. Was Europe too fast? Has it grown too big and too complex? So that there is these retreat movements where people say, I want to have something, get something back, which I know has Europe eaten more than it could chew?
You know, it's clear that people feel this way. But the difficulty when one tries to predict the future of something that is measured in decades is to separate out what sort of things affect it long term and what sort of things are perturbations one way or another. So I'm reminded that I don't know what it's like in Germany, actually, but in America we have to invest our own pension money in a special account. And the advice is always, don't try to buy and sell stocks every day, respond to every new piece of information. Pick a few things that are long-term, hold them, and you'll be right more often than you're wrong. And that's the way I think about political prognostication. Maybe it's true that we're standing before an epochal change in political culture, in which people are going to become more and more radical. But I think that the evidence for that is slim, and it's also hard to argue that that is separated from much more fundamental trends. So let's just take the history of European integration. I mean, it's true that people were pro-European or anti-European. It had certain ideological resonance. But most of the time, countries did and leaders did what it was in their long-term self-interest to do. And actually, the countries that support things like agricultural policy, things like free trade, things like the monetary union, things like enlargement, things like foreign policy cooperation, are remarkably similar to what they were 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. Even the fact that Britain is a little bit of an outlier on both the extent of interest convergence with the rest of Europe and in the ideological factors influences that. So if we want to make Europe more credible to people, and it's striking also that this real problem with legitimating Europe doesn't start with, you know, 1980 or 1990 when you could have said Europe was getting complex, Europe was getting distant. In fact, most people don't even know what goes on in most of the European institutions. And if you ask them, they actually trust them more than their national parliaments. So it's very hard to argue that it's just some belief about distant bureaucrats. That belief about distant bureaucrats is an effect. It's an effect of policies that don't work or policies that people want changed domestically and internationally, or at the European level, starting with the euro, but there are others as well. And so I think that's the place to start. One needs to start, I agree with Jan, actually, one needs to start with domestic political economy, which would make both national governments in Europe stronger. But insofar as we can affect what people think about the European project, I believe it's hopeless to try to come up with a discourse about liberalism or about Europe or about anything else unattached to things that are real in the world. I mean, I don't know why I'm saying this to the party of Ferdinand LaSalle. It should be pretty clear. It's these fundamental and often largely material interests that drive people's satisfaction and dissatisfaction with politics. That's true everywhere. And so that's what we need to fix to start with. And I think both the history of European integration and an analysis of who's upset about the status quo and why support that view.
Jetzt nochmal umgekehrt gefragt, man könnte doch auch behaupten, dass gerade...
Reversely, you could say that with these populists, with the problems they have in Europe, the interest with what happens in the other countries has grown enormously. I've never witnessed such that many people were interested in how big anti-abortion demonstrations were in Warsaw, or how Dutch elections results. I grew up with Einer wird gewinnen, a German popular game show that was European socialization at the time. But after that, there was a drought where everybody thought that the transformation and integration process was a given. And all of a sudden, we have the problems, and now we start being interested in what Kaczynski is doing in Poland. What do they do with the parliament there? Couldn't we just say that we are at a moment that where we should start being interested in the neighboring countries, that this is already happening?
But in the broader society, no. I don't think many people's view about the European Union or German foreign policy or anything else is driven by what they think about Kaczynski. That's a luxury for people who are informed about politics. And let's not forget that many of these things are not as new as we think. I mean, what was going on in the 1960s? You had General de Gaulle and, you know, Konrad Adenauer, and then you had Willy Brandt and General de Gaulle's successors. You had people that were ideologically very different, in fact, in many respects, anti-European. They moved things forward in a pragmatic way. The elites papered over the ideological differences, and it, in fact, French policy continued in a similar direction under Mitterrand, who was the opposite, right? I mean, you have all kinds of ideological changes. You had, you know, 20-30% of French, 20-30% of Italians, 10% of Germans voting for what we political scientists call non-system parties, parties that were not really fully committed to liberal capitalist democracy, but, you know, they survived these kinds of things because there was a kind of underlying momentum to the project. I persist in thinking, and that's the source of my optimism, that no amount of debate about this or that individual in this or that country changes these fundamental trends. And that's why I'm so skeptical about Brexit. You know, Brexit just seems to me on its face absurd. And you can see it's absurd because the British negotiating position, which is supposed to be what a country wants in its dreams, is so much like what we have now. Right? That's what matters. You can say what you want to electorates, but in the end, you have to pursue policies that are very constrained by various kinds of fiscal, you know, economic, and ideological reality that are much less variable than what we see day to day to day. So I really think we want to avoid, you know, we have a phrase in America which fortunately I think doesn't exist in German, which is ambulance chasing. So when people see an ambulance going to an accident, lawyers go with the ambulance because they think somebody's going to sue somebody else. And we call this ambulance
wir
chasing.
Wir haben ein klein bisschen anderes Rechtssystem, deswegen.
It's good so. But I think there's something like that with headlines, that things change, the identity of people changes day to day. We have a crisis, largely material crisis, and all of a sudden people ambulance chase in a certain direction. I think we really need to focus on fundamentals.
Jan Silonkamp möchte da gerne sehr, sehr sofort darauf antworten. Bitte.
Zanko wants to ask right away.
I totally agree with Andy that...
I think you two shouldn't agree all the time. I mean, your keynotes were totally different.
Let me finish the sentence, yeah.
It's always a but.
I totally agree with Andy that Brexit vote is an absurd. I recently spent 2 days with Boris Johnson, and I thought that in private he's different than in public, but no hope. But that is exactly the point. We are living in absurdistan. That's you know, what usually rational logic would not accept takes place. This is a new world. It didn't have to be like that, but symbolic politics took over from real politics, and anything goes. And you see, what I tried to say is, of course, that those who were in power for all these years, they tried to ignore the very basic truth. That, and this is historical truth, and again, I agree with Andy, it is a long-term processes to which we have not adjusted. I give you, what has happened in 89? Yeah? We, more or less at the same time, we experienced three profound revolutions. The one was, of course, geopolitical. You know, the Berlin Wall collapse, Soviet Union collapse, Yugoslavia collapse, and you know the story, right? People, borders moved, states disappeared, other enlarged, and so on, right? Then we had globalization and European versions of this single market, which was the economic revolution. And you know what this had mean. It produced gains, winners and losers, and it changed the way we've run economics. But the most important of those was the internet revolution, because it had influence on all the others. You know, it changed the way democracy works. It changed the way we communicate. Look, why all those newspapers are struggling or collapsing? It changed the way the business worked, because today you cannot tax financial transactions if they are over seconds on computer all over the world, right? And we haven't adjusted to those changes. We thought this was the end of history. We don't need to do much. Tell me how much. No, these were those counter-revolutionaries who tried to experiment with e-democracy. We never did experiment. We've seen that the parties and parliaments do not function, so obviously parliamentary representation doesn't work, but we haven't done anything about this. You know, we've seen that the economics is becoming kind of casino capitalism, and we waited before it got busted, right? And when it got busted, the first thing is we reached to the pocket of ordinary taxpayers to bail out the banks. And after all these years, they haven't changed very much, frankly. And when people were saying we need to do something, they were silenced. When I wrote a few years ago that we need profound changes of European integration, people thought I'm crazy. When people were saying, okay, Farage didn't get votes in British Parliament, but he came first in European Parliament, they thought they can get away with this. And then you have a Brexit, and you are surprised, you got a Brexit. Of course, it was not just Farage. There were all these other, and you know, travelers trying to get into positions by basically campaigning on his ticket. And you can go on and on and on. Look at examples, we thought we can get away with everything.
Sind wir wirklich immer davon gekommen? Also
now, did we manage to get out? I mean, have we always opted out of these debates? Ralf, I see you want to answer. Now, we've had lots of controversies all these years. I mean, it's not like we were just fast asleep and overlooking the imminent disaster. We talked about how to shape globalization and what to do about TTIP and CETA. We talked about how to avoid or how to prevent our societies from drifting apart, because Brexit was only partly about sovereignty and Europe. It was first and foremost also an echo to the social, regional and national distortions in the UK, in Great Britain, and also an indicator of the anger people felt with respect to the dominant elites in their country. And we also dealt with the question euro policy and how to deal with the debt crisis, criticism of the austerity policy, investment for infrastructure and ecological renewal and innovation. I mean, there are political alternatives, and that's what we said, and that's what we talked about time and again. This is where we need to get back to, because we need to negotiate alternative options. This is not about the Sachzwang policy, the policy of constraints, a technocratic policy of constraints, which pretends that there is nothing you can decide anymore. Politics lives on decisions, and decisions live on alternative options. But there is a fundamental aspect I would like to mention here with respect to the European Union, because Juncker recently did something we did not expect. He did not say, this is what we need today, more integration. But he asked, what could the EU look like? Now, my question for you, and since we're talking about critical self-reflection and the software, in view of the crises all around us, a collapsing NATO, fragile states, China, Russia, a country that challenge us ideologically, China, for example, which still calls itself a communist country in spite of the fact that it has a powerful Manchester capitalism implemented, there is a lack of optimism and self-confidence with respect to the universal values of our own societies. Now, if the EU was destroyed today, wouldn't we have to rebuild it tomorrow? And if so, what would it look like? My question to the three of you. I mean, is the basis wrong? Are there fixes which can be done? Are there things we can mend inside of the system? Do we just need the software update? Ralf, you talked about different speeds. I mean, can it work at different speeds? Because I think that the debate about democracy and capitalism alone won't help us save the EU. We will have to make sure that it can work for the more and function. How?
Look, first of all, politics was always there. Globalization didn't come from the sky. We were the leaders of globalization. We privatized everything. We allowed to be, you know, everything to be bought by money. I mean, recently we had the Ferrari owners organize dinner on Ponte Vecchio in Florence. I mean, this tells you that money can buy everything these days, right? So we have done those things ourselves. They were political decisions. When I asked Wim Kok, who was 10 years prime minister, leading socialist government in Holland, what was his biggest disappointment when he stepped down, he said, the very fact that me, who was the leader of trade union, you know, I basically allowed decompositions of the welfare state. And I said, you were prime minister. And he said, well, but there was always some economic advisor. He said, we cannot do that, we should do that. And this is how it happened. But what I want to say about your question is this. There are various ways of looking at those things. You know, but and we don't know what will happen tomorrow. You have to ask a fortune teller to answer the question. What I know is only one thing. That if formal institutions stop delivering goodies, the informal take over. You see, the formal divorce is very costly. This is why Greece didn't go out, of the euro. This is why Britain, and he and is absolutely right, will learn hard way what does it mean to get out in a formal ways. You know, these 20,000 laws and regulations, to untangle all those things, hardly impossible, and I see already lawyers making billions out of this. But it doesn't change the fact that certain institutions are there to solve problems. And if they don't, they are like Western European Union, who existed I don't know how many decades, and it was all fake, because each time there was a crisis in security field, you know, they called coalitions of willing contact groups, United Nations, OECD, everything, but not Western European Union, because everybody know that this is not serious. That is the problem. It's not that they will just say, okay, guys, we don't play this game any longer, we go home, we take the toys, and everything will be fine in nation state. No. It is simply that they will meet, they will agree, and then nothing.
Machen wir es doch mal konkret. Dann würde das doch wirklich heißen, dass...
But this means to equip a European foreign policy with an apparatus, a well-funded one, a well-coordinated one, you are not agreeing.
Now we sort of agree that there are real problems, and the question is whether the institution can solve the real problems. Many of the fundamental changes in the architecture of the EU, the move toward more decision-making in the Council, multi-speed Europe, have already been done. They've been around for several decades. The question is these issues. So my position in the talk was that migration was a problem, but it could be solved and was being solved within the current institutions, and that the euro was a problem, and that's much harder to solve within the current institutions. But these two problems are different from all the rest of the things the European Union does, because they're things that lots of voters care about. Nobody is going to cast a vote because they don't like the way the Macedonian Stabilization Force has been constituted, right? They will cast a vote because they think Italy is fundamentally doing poorly economically, or because they don't favor the immigration policy. So that's where the focus should be. On common foreign and security policy, then, people don't really care that much about it. I mean, everyday voters. So you're not going to get much benefit either way. But insofar as we want an effective European common and foreign security policy, it has to be flexible. It would be a disaster if you needed to have 27 or 28 people vote for something in order to do it. It would be a disaster if everybody had to send soldiers to every mission and so on and so forth. It would be a disaster if every time countries wanted to abstain because they don't like the principle, that ruined the issue. I think we need to ask ourselves, how many times in the last 25 years has the decentralized common foreign and security policy failed to do something that 28 countries would support if they were all voting on it, or even half of 28 countries would support if you were voting about it in a majority framework? And the answer is rarely or never. Actually, the common foreign and security policy works pretty well, and it's more the way we talk about the common foreign and security policy that's the problem. So I think we really need to focus on the issues that drive voters, migration and macroeconomics, and fix them.
And fix them. That's the easy part.
Well, the first part is, I think the migration crisis is actually pretty much something people agree on how it's going to be fixed. Macroeconomics, as I said, I'm less optimistic.
Ja, zwei Argumente eingehen. Das eine ist die...
Let me comment on two arguments. A, the importance or significance of institutions. We imply that we need to defend the liberal democracy, and the question is, of course, how do we get forward here, which is surprising, because 2 years ago things would have been very different. People would not have identified with this particular political concept, right? Now we're doing this because liberal democracy is under attack, which is the reason why people start and remember the qualities of liberal democracies. But what does this mean? This is also about reorientation and the rehabilitation of what liberal democracy is in view of the trends Jan has described, i.e. The reduction to market liberalism and the mantra of deregulation, less state is better, is the slogan here. And the core problem of this reduced liberalism is the significance of public institutions, and this does not mean government institutions only. It also means the public educational system, infrastructure, public transport, short distance and long distance. Now, these are not only technical infrastructures. This is actually our common good. These are republican institutions, actually. And we need to invest more for these public institutions, which is at the same time an answer to the increasing social injustice and also an answer to the question, how can people identify with a liberal community and society? Now, that's one answer to the question. The second one is, I agree, there are some political fields where we need European initiatives. These need to be urgent matters, and people need to understand where the added value of European cooperation is. However, this cannot and must not happen in a one-fits-all approach. And it cannot be the uniformity of the 28, but we'll need coalitions, alliances of the powerful ones, the strong ones who start off as leaders so that the others follow. Be it renewable energies, like a European Alliance for Renewable Energies, people who or countries that go and say, we start off and the others will follow, or be it refugee policy, where we won't have a consensus of the 28 in the near future, but most probably a consensus of 6 or 7 or 8 nations who go and say, we want a refugee policy which is more than the limitation of refugee numbers. This needs to be about quotas, humanitarian quotas, and the joint funding of integration, for example, integration programs. And here too, we need a progressive alliance, like in defense policy. I mean, there were approaches made by France, Poland, and Germany, and we could broaden the scope here and go beyond the mere procurement and go and build up step by step joint army units. Now, these would be real steps towards more Europe. And I guess there'd be a major support for these ideas in the public. However, it's certainly more difficult with respect to the European Monetary Union, i.e. the aspect Andrew has mentioned, because this is much more about institutional solutions, joint institutional solutions, i.e. moving the EU towards a monetary or a fiscal unit. And this is also about redistribution policy on a European scale. And this might be dangerous ground, because this is once again about delivery and the connection between hardware and software. Now, Andrew wants to answer, which means that you won't have an opportunity to ask questions.
America, because I want to very strongly support what Ralf said in his first point. The real fight in America for the next 4 years is not about foreign policy. I mean, I know all American administrations, presidents, are a little crazy for the first year. Bush was, Reagan was, Carter was, they all are. But actually, when you look at at Trump for the first 3 months. I mean, he announced a policy for China, reversed it. He announced a policy for Japan, reversed it. Announced a policy for Korea, reversed it. Announced a policy for Israel, reversed it. Announced a policy toward NATO, reversed it. Announced a policy toward the EU, reversed it. And next comes Russia. Okay, so, you know, there is a reality in foreign policy that it's very difficult to overcome. The danger is that this is the first time in America, with the exception of a few moments in the post-war period, the first time since the Second World War when we've had complete Republican rule in the court, in the Congress, which is the powerful institution in Washington, and the presidency. The real fight is about whether or not we will defund public institutions even more. And that creates a kind of change that's self-reinforcing. And it's not by chance that people like Breitbart think about what the political implications are of defunding universities, the political implications of defunding the arts, the political implications of defunding the cities. This is what the real fight in America is going to be about. It's a tough fight, but at least we can say that probably most of these foreign policy issues, barring some really unfortunate incident, are going to be of secondary importance, although I understand that in Germany you pay a lot of attention to it.
So, da wir jetzt sowieso etwas tun, was eigentlich sehr...
Right. What we are going to do now is very unlike Heinrich-Böll Foundation. We won't have any questions in here, no Q&A session, but the coffee break. And yet, over the coffee break or in the coffee break, you can furthermore ponder the idea of self-criticism and the question, what has gone wrong? Why have we ended up in a situation which is fatal? And what can we do in order to strengthen what we want to see strong? And this is not about a stronger or more powerful software. This is about the institutions. We need to look at the institutions and make them strong. So that at the end we get something which is extremely important for the EU and all other institutions, i.e. it needs to be capable of delivering. And delivering seems to be one of the problems of the EU, I guess, because often it delivers, but people do not see that there has been something delivered. Right. Thank you very much, and please bear with us. No Q&A session now, but carry your questions along. The hosts of the next sessions are looking forward to your questions then. Thank you for listening. Thank you for speaking to and with us.